Hi, welcome back to another Deep Dive with Colin. Today's video comes via request from our last SPE class. They wanted a little bit more information about how to separate color blends within Illustrator. So to do that, I whipped up this little design here, and we created the tutorial in Illustrator on how to go about separating the blends. Then we jumped up here on Press to show what we did in Illustrator, how it looks on the shirt itself. So this is for you guys last week. Thank you very much for the suggestion. Let's jump into Illustrator and show you how it's done. Usually when you get a piece of art from your customer, it's going to come over to you in a CMYK mode. And blends in CMYK mode look amazing. But when you convert them to spot color, you'll start to notice that there's this midpoint, this hazy center line within the blend itself. And this is actually kind of accurate to how a standard blend is going to look if we create films just by hitting print. That midpoint where it looks a little hazy, that's where the two colors meet at a 50% point. Now, if you have printed halftones already, then you will know that if you take a 50% point and print that, and then another one on top of it, they don't spread out very much. As a result, you'd get a lot of that negative space, that background color coming through, and you can get these two colors when they're blending, have that background color coming through, and it ends up looking hazy. So this is actually a truer representation of how it's going to look on the shirt. So we need to fix that. How do we go about fixing that? Well, let me give you a quick breakdown of what we're going to be working with as we go through and separate it. This is that same blend, and then this is that same blend with very basic color separations. What I did was I duplicated this box and went copy, paste in front. So I have a secondary image or secondary design on top of it. And then what I did was I took one of the colors in that design and just changed it to white. In the case of this one, I took the yellow and made it white, and the opacity I set it to zero. So we're seeing a very clean, very true version of the individual blend by itself. Did the same thing with the yellow. Get these two to blend, sit on top of each other. But the problem comes in where we talked about how we have that haze in the middle. Well, we still have this haze here. It's very clear and very obvious. So we need to find a way to get those two points to overlap. And that's what I ended up doing over here, was I took that, this is the same separation with a small change. I took this midpoint that you see here at the 50% point on our slider, and I slid it over. In this case, I moved it over 25%. Now, this is not a true scale of 0 to 100% or anything like that. It's just a matter of where this spot falls in relation to this spot and this spot. So if midpoint on this is at 50, moving it over so that we have some overlapping, and we can roughly translate it to percentages, so that 50% point moves over to where that 75% point is, and it ends up creating better saturation. I did the same thing here with the yellow, but because it's going towards a different end, the numbers go in the opposite direction. So instead of 75, it's now 25, but they both correlate to each other based on that 0 to 100 scale. Starting in the middle at 50, dropping down 25 gives us 25. Starting in the middle at 50 and going up 25 gives us 75. So this is a very easy way to see how that blend works. The other thing you'll notice is that the saturation looks really nice, and that's specifically because of this blending mode. I'm using multiply actually on both of those colors. It's not necessary, but we can do it. So that red on top is blending into the gold that's underneath it. Even if I change this and arrange, bring to front, get those both centered. Now the yellow is not, sorry, the yellow did not have a blending mode on it, but if I give it a blending mode,
This is basically the best way I can describe the process of printing wet on wet by using these blending modes. That yellow printing on top of the red, giving you a very clean, very smooth color transition. Your mileage may vary. But that's what we're looking for when it comes to creating color separations out of a blend. We want to get to something like this on press. I'm going to turn that off. I'm going to turn this off. And we're going to go through the steps of actually color separating this design. Now, I'm going to duplicate this a couple of times. I'm going to name this one original. And then I'm going to turn the eyeball off on it as a way to keep it safe. If I ever need to go back to it to correct a mistake, I know it's there. This one we're going to label black and red. I'm going to turn off the eyeball on it, and this one I'll name yellow. So we're going to be working on the yellow. I want to remove the black. There we go. And I want to remove these two little pieces because there's no, this is not connected to the blend. So we're going to click this. I'm going to already set it to multiply so I don't forget later. And now because we're working on a yellow, I'm going to go over here to the red. I'm going to double click it for ease. I'm going to make it a white spot color, just like you saw me do with the triangles that were over here. Sorry, the diamond shapes that were over here. I'm going to take that white, drop the opacity down to zero. Basically what it does is it just helps with any blending that's going to happen later on. The white doesn't interfere with anything. And that's the basics of that color separation. That part's done. Now I need to change that midpoint. I'm going to be printing out at about 50 or 55 lines per inch. So I don't need a massive amount of overlap, but I need to understand that negative space between the dots. And so I'm going to go a factor of 20. So I'm going to go down from 50, down 20 from 50. So I'm going to 30. So we have this little bit of extra saturation here. Now we're going to go to the black and red. I'm going to leave the black alone. The red, I'm going to take the yellow, and I'm going to show you a different way to do this. I'm going to take the white and drag it over. And now it's become white, and I'm going to set that opacity to zero. So if I was to turn on the yellow at this point, you can see that there's a little more saturation in the yellow into the red, but we still have that fuzzy midpoint. Turn that off. Now I'm going to take this slider, and I'm going to move that up the same amount that I did with the yellow, but of course in the other numerical direction. So slide that up. I'm just going to go up here and hit 70 and call that good. So this midpoint has been dragged up. On the yellow, that midpoint has been dragged down, and now we have much nicer color saturation. Now, when it comes to printing this wet on wet, there are a couple of things that we need to pay attention to. If I print this red first and then the yellow on top and then the black, while the blend's going to look really good, that yellow is going to fall on top of some pretty saturated, the yellow is going to fall on top of red, which can end up coming up through the print, which is something that's undesirable. Typically, if we're going to do a wet on wet print for a color blend, I would want to have another color in between the two so that the red got pushed into the shirt. And the likelihood of the color coming up into the next screen is minimized or eliminated. So for this, I'm probably going to end up flashing in between, which is totally fine and very acceptable. So when I see you guys next, we're going to end up talking about the actual print itself, and we're going to discuss how good a job I did, or if I did something terrible and I should have gone back and made some adjustments.
So we're back on press after doing separations in Illustrator. I've chosen a couple of the Rio RFU inks, specifically the Scarlet and the Light Gold, where in the Illustrator video you saw me using a very bright red and a bright yellow. Those are not colors that I really want to use to create a sunset. I want to use something that feels a little bit more a little softer. As I stumble over my words, I want something that's a little softer. So I chose the Scarlet, which is a little bit more on the orange side, and not quite so strong, and then the Light Gold, so it's not a clean, hard, strong yellow. And also when I print those are gonna naturally blend together better. If you're choosing colors that are, you know, diametrically opposed, you know, hard contrast on either side, any flaw in your print is going to be magnified because of that. So anyways, I digress. Let's print some ink. So this is the Scarlet. I went ahead and did my separations and did the halftones at 50 lines per inch. And then I shot them on some 230 mesh that I had sitting around over the last couple of weeks. And I discovered a couple of things. Well, I rediscovered a couple of things. Specifically, you don't want to shoot fine detail on screens that you've been saving in high temperatures over the course of a couple of weeks, which is in itself a different deep dive talking about care and feeding of your screens when you're drying them and when you are storing them over a period of time. The short answer is the longer you store a screen, the more that emulsion is cross-linking over time, just very slow. So your fine details can end up getting a little clipped and lost simply because the emulsion's exposed in those areas. So I went ahead and flashed the red like we were talking about. I didn't want to do the wet on wet directly into another color because I'll get ink transfer. And now I'm going to print the gold. That's what we've got after those two colors. The gold can be a little speckled if you're flashing everything. So again, this is just an example of one of the things that we can do. I'm now going to flash that. Not so much an example of what you can do. It's just one way of printing, and I'll show you a couple of different ways of printing this one. And there we go. The blend is printed. The colors overlap very nicely. It is a very saturated design, which is what we were going for. We wanted that saturation. Now in this saturation, you might find that, ooh, I did too much. And that's great. That's the learning experience that you want, because now you can go back in on that midpoint and change it from a 70, which is where we left off at, down to 65. Maybe you go down to a 60. It's all about what you need in your shop with your tools. Let's do this one more time, and we're gonna do this with a little bit of a wet on wet. I have a blank screen over here that can imitate another color that could print in between, and we'll see how it looks when everything is printed wet on wet. So as we take a close-up look of what this red looks like, you can see evidence of a couple of things. Part of this is the emulsion sitting for 2 weeks in temperature ranges from 80 to 100 degrees. And so that emulsion started to cross-link a little bit. That's a little bit of what we got going on here. We got a little bit of a wavy pattern because of that. Storing coated screens. When we're talking about storing them for 2, 3, 4 weeks, if you're storing them at elevated temperatures, you can find that the emulsion starts to cross-link over time. It's just a natural behavior of emulsion. And if you're storing them at elevated temperatures, then that's going to happen faster. These screens are about 2 weeks old, and they were stored at elevated temperatures the majority of that time. So when it came to rinsing out finer details, that 5% to 1% dot, I definitely had some problems. And I ended up getting a pattern in my print because of that. So I'm now going to print this as if there was another screen coming down. And I'm going to smush the red into the shirt fiber. We were talking about how wet on wet, I don't want this red to come up here into the screen of the gold that I'm printing. If during the print process you have a respectable amount of ink on the shirt and then another screen comes down right after it and you've got another appreciable amount of ink in that same zone, that red dot that drops on top of the shirt can end up going into the screen as it comes down and you print. There can be a little bit of mixing of the ink in that screen. And then because it's red into a gold color, I'll end up with the red streaks. Having another screen in between that presses that color thinner greatly reduces that likelihood of ink transferring into your screen. So I'm going to flood and then print. And that's what it looks like before another color comes in and prints on top of that gold, pushing it into the red. Now this is going to be the first print, so there's going to be a little bit of pick off. It's not going to be as saturated, but our goal for demonstration will be achieved. And there we go. A much smoother print when compared to the design where we flashed every color. Both choices are totally fine. It's up to you, the printer, to decide where you want that look to go. And as long as your customer is happy, that's all that matters. So when you print wet on wet, that blending is going to be enhanced by those dots physically mixing together in the ink. When you flash each color, those dots are going to become more visible. They have room to stand up with contrast around them. And you can see that here with the gold on top of the red, that small dottiness that can happen. Is this bad? No, it's just different. And how this looks is your choice of how it looks. Now, when I look at this and I decide to print wet on wet, I go, oh, my blend overlaps are a little bit further than I want. But if I am flashing each color, my blend overlaps are pretty close to what I want. When I print wet on wet, I get enhanced dot gain, meaning when that dot drops and hits the shirt, it doesn't maintain its shape. It's always going to spread a little bit. So that negative space between dots gets a little slimmer. Now, if I have that dot when I print it and then I flash it, that space in between remains there pretty intact. But if I print wet on wet, that dot is going to spread out a little bit more, enclosing that background, that white background a little bit more. So whether or not you flash your design or print wet on wet, completely up to you. The results are for you to determine as to what's better for you in your print shop and or for your customer. And we're going to leave it on that note today. If you like what you saw here, leave a comment. If you have questions, deeper questions about what we did here, leave a comment. If I glossed over something or missed something in what we were talking about today, leave a comment. Just don't flame me too bad, and we'll have a conversation about it. We're all human and we do make mistakes. Thank you very much for watching this deep dive. We'll see you in the next one.